Welcome to the second run-through of the Lakeside Institute of Theology English Language Curriculum. The courses that we're doing, there are already videotapes online for all of these lectures, with the exception of a couple where we had technical problems or something, and so you will be able to go back and watch this in two different versions. We'll see which one you like more. Come in, Cheryl. A couple of things I want to explain is what the Lakeside Institute of Theology is and who I am, and then we'll get into some of these documents. First, early on, when I became pastor at Lakeside Presbyterian Church, some comments from some people that had been in church apparently most of their lives indicated there was a real lack of understanding about what's in Scripture, what the Bible says, what it means. Somebody commented to me one time, we were talking about Paul, and they said, so Paul, is he like before or after the Ten Commandments? And I said at that point, okay, we need a lot of work. So we decided to launch the Lakeside Institute of Theology, and we now have done the entire curriculum in English through Once Time, that's 27 courses, and in Spanish. And then Guillermo would take my courses in English, and then he would translate the materials into Spanish, and he currently is doing this same course again, a second time, in Spanish. They're meeting Tuesdays and Thursdays, I think it is. So, the Lakeside Institute, and that's how we got started, is just simply to have a comprehensive training opportunity for people. We as Christians have not only the right, but the responsibility, I think, to know more about the Word of God and more about how that applies to our lives. And that's what the Instituto is all about. We are licensed by the Mexican government as an Instituto. We are granted permission to give certificates and degrees. If anybody's thinking about taking this in order to go back to the States and getting a job as a theology professor, we are not accredited by any U.S. accrediting agency. Well, we are licensed by the Mexican government. Most of the people who take these classes take it just for personal growth, and that's great. That's primarily the reason we did it. But it is also possible for you to take this for either a certificate of biblical studies. There's two levels of certificates, and you look at that in a minute. There's two levels of degree that we will offer if you complete all of the requirements. Now, but you don't have to do that. You can just take this for personal growth, and that's a wonderful reason to do it. Now, who I am, most of you all know me as pastor of the church. I think everybody here is from the church. We sometimes have had other people come in. But I have a Master of Divinity, MDiv, as it's called, from Fuller Seminary, with an emphasis in systematic and philosophical theology. That's the stuff that I really get excited about, even though most other people don't so much. And I also have all but dissertation for a THM, or Master of Theology, from Regent College in Vancouver, BC. For 18 years, I was teaching at University Presbyterian Church in Seattle every week. We had a class called Sunday School for Adults, which is where we picked up the class for our Sunday morning here, and all kinds of different topics. And then, of course, senior pastor here and the primary lecturer in English for the Instituto. I will say right up front, I am an evangelical. What does that mean? It means that I believe that the Bible is the Word of God. I believe Jesus was the Son of God who came as a human being in order to live as a human, to die, to pay atonement for our sins. And I take that very seriously. And particularly as we look at this Old Testament, the emphasis on being an evangelical is that I believe that the Bible is the Word of God and that it is truth for us. And we'll talk about that as we go along. Now, a couple of different handouts I gave you. The first one, look at the one that says policies and requirements at the top. Lakeside Institute of Theology, policies and requirements. We don't have any rules here, but there are a few things. First, classes are free. You don't have to pay anything for this. But if you want to get a certificate or a degree, then I do require you to buy the books. Now, 250 pesos is all we're charging for this, and this time we're using the same book for both of these courses. So it is not a big deal in terms of price, a lot less than the books that we were using the first time, but I've sort of explained why that is. If you are taking this for a certificate or a degree, which I'll explain in a minute, then you can miss no more than one class meeting out of the eight during the period of this course without talking to me about it, making arrangements to make it up. One of the reasons that we videotape this is for people who can't be live at the courses, but also in case people miss courses, they can make that up. I'll talk about that again in a minute. Students in the certificate or degree tracks do have to take a test. It is a pass-fail test. It's usually 50 questions, multiple choice. There's no essay questions. You don't have no even fill in the blank. You just have to pick the right answer. About the fifth week of this course, I will give you a document called What You Need to Know from Old Testament Survey. And if you learn what's in that document, you will know everything you need to know to pass the test. For those of you who've been in my classes, is that not true? Okay, Lydia, I know. Carolyn. So I will tell you, my point here is not to give you a test, to see if you fail. My point is to, when you study for an exam and you take an exam, you will learn the material better. And I will tell you exactly what you need to know. And so I encourage all of you, even if you're just doing this for personal growth, I encourage you to study the stuff and take the exam. It's not like it's going to go on your permanent record. I always say, permanent record. Remember that? Permanent record. This is going to go in your permanent record was always the threat. Where is my permanent record now? It's permanent. It's got to be someplace. But no. There is no long-term record of this. There is no downside to taking the test, even if you don't pass it. And you only have to get 61 out of 100. I mean, anything over 60 is a passing score. And it's very rare for somebody not to pass one of these tests. Usually it's because they just didn't read it at all, didn't study at all. Okay? So I encourage you to do that. If you're taking this for a certificate or degree, that's a requirement. You have to do that. If you're in the... if you want to be a candidate for a degree that is a Master of Theology or a Master of Theology in Ministry, then you need to talk to me about why you want to do that. So discuss it with me if you're interested in those things. All of that is written on this paper, so you can take it with you. If you do miss a class and want to make it up, there are specific instructions here for how to do that. Because when we first started doing these courses, I'd have people say, oh, I watched the video, everything's fine. Or later on, I would say, you missed three classes. Oh, but I made them up. And I didn't know. No, how am I supposed to know that? So here, on this same sheet of paper that has the policies and requirements, it's got the requirements for making up classes. You have to complete it, the makeup, that is, watch the video, look at the PowerPoint, all of this stuff is online, and read the materials before the end of the term. Okay, you can't do this 2 years from now and come back and tell me, oh, I want credit now because I took that stuff. And you have to email me to the address on here, rda@rossarnold.net, and you have to give me this information, which video you watched, each separate video. Don't send me a message and say, I watched all of the videos for Old Testament Survey. Because I've had people who, well, I need you to tell me, I watched this video and this video and this video. You must tell me what the course was. OT1 is this class. It's our first Old Testament course. And the name of it, the date of the lecture you missed, the title of the lecture, and a clear statement that says, yes, I watched the video, I read the materials, and I looked at the PowerPoint. That's all you need. But I have to have at least that much in order to be able to say, if you're going to receive a certificate or degree, that you fulfill the requirements. And when we started out doing this, there were no rules, and people just took it too lightly. And so that's the requirement. Any questions about any of that? All right, this is the only time we're going to have to go through this stuff, so it's not a big deal. Now, the second sheet, the one that says Lakeside Institute of Theology, it's the two-column one. It says course schedule and descriptions. All right? Here are both of the courses that we're teaching this term, Old Testament Survey and New Testament Survey, and a paragraph description of it, when it meets, etc. This course will meet every Friday from 1 to 3. There will be one week, the 18th of November, when I can't be here. I have to be at meetings in the States related to client work. So we'll actually go until the 16th of December. Every Friday, 1 to 3, and you've got the description there. Now, at the very bottom of that first column on the left-hand side, you'll see certificate and degree offerings. We have two certificates that you can receive. A certificate of biblical studies, which requires 8 courses. 2 in Old Testament, 3 in New Testament, 2 in what's called Christian maturity, and 1 in theology. If you complete those, Take the test, make it at least 61 or better on the test, then you can receive a certificate of biblical studies. We've had quite a lot of people who've done that. The next level of certificate is certificate of biblical maturity. It's everything for the first biblical studies, plus one more Old Testament course, one more New Testament course, one more Christian maturity course, and one more theology course, as you can see here. Then the first degree we offer is Master of Theology. It's 19 courses, as indicated here. And then the highest level we offer is a Master of Theology in Ministry, which is 24 courses. On the right-hand column, you can see all of the courses that are part of our curriculum. There are 6 Old Testament courses, so the most we require for any degree is 5. You don't have to take all of them. You can. We've had people who have. But you take any of those. The New Testament courses, we have 6 of. We have 5 Christian maturity, we're calling them, which basically, like how to study the Bible, spiritual disciplines, practical theology. Then the theology courses, 2 church history, 2 systematic theology, and 1 philosophical theology. And then Christian leadership. If you want to learn more about how you can be involved in teaching and preaching, being in leadership role, biblical interpretation, communications and homiletics, Christian ethics, worship, and then the preparation for ministry. Those are the courses we will offer. Now, in the past, I was doing 3 courses a week, 3 courses at a time. So I was lecturing 6 hours a week, and it almost killed me. I would get to the end of the 8 weeks and, need to lock myself in my room for a long time. So I was taking 2 or 3 months before I could generate enough energy to come back and do this again. That's why I'm only teaching 2 courses now. And my plan is for us to do the 2 courses. These end on the 16th of December. We will pick up the next term, the 1st of January. And the next term would be Old Testament theology and New Testament theology. This is survey. The difference is the survey courses, Old and New Testament, deal with what is in the Bible. What does it say? The theology courses are what does it mean? What is it we learn from that in terms of what God wants for us to know? Because the Bible is given to us for 2 reasons. So that we can know more about God, who he is, and we can know more about ourselves and who we are, and how those things go together, us and God. So theology is where you begin to answer those kinds of questions. Survey classes, this one in the New Testament, are what is in the Bible. And so we'll deal with that for these courses. Any questions about any of that?
So are you saying that next term, in January, you will not be teaching the New Testament survey?
No, New Testament survey is tomorrow.
Right, but right. The next term it's not going to be offered.
Nope. I can only do 2 courses at a time, and if I taught that one every time, I wouldn't get around to anything else.
That's right.
Okay?
And so it might be a really long time before it's
taught again. Now, there are videos of all these courses online. So you can go on for personal growth. Now, if you want to get a certificate or a degree, we're not doing that online. Again, we started out doing that and it became way too complicated. I had people quite literally from all over the world wanting me to, on a weekly basis, work with them and answer questions and send them tests and grade the tests, and it didn't work. There wasn't time for it. So, but if you're interested in the materials, all of this stuff is already, the videos are already on there. It's on the LIT Chapala website, litchapala.org. All of the videos, all of the PowerPoint presentations, all of that is on there, okay? So you can study for yourself, certainly.
But there is a chance that you will repeat those courses in the future, maybe 3 years or something.
Maybe. We'll see. I wondered whether, because again, teaching even 2 courses at a time is, and even courses I've taught before, there's a lot of time involved in this, and that's time I can't be doing something else. Okay, good. All right, any other questions? Then the third document is the one that relates more specifically to where we are today. And that is the course schedule, description, and outline. This information at the top is exactly the same as the last sheet I gave you. The last sheet has both the Old Testament survey and New Testament survey. This repeats the Old Testament, so this is just for this course. And it is an outline of what the topics are going to be for the next 8 weeks. And so I want to sort of walk through that right now so you have a sense of it. Today we are going to be dealing with an introduction which will address authority and interpretation of the Old Testament for Christians. I had the experience a few years ago of preaching in a local church, and I preached from the Old Testament. After I preached, someone came up to me and said that the previous minister there had been there for 11 years and he had never preached from the Old Testament because he didn't believe in it. He thought the Old Testament was for the Jews, the New Testament is for Christians. There is nothing further from the truth. In fact, that's heresy. All of Scripture. There's a reason why your Bibles have an Old Testament and New Testament in them, because that while the word testament, a better word for that is covenant, which really means agreement. There was the covenant agreement that God had with the Hebrew people, which is the Old Covenant or Old Testament. There is the covenant that God renewed, especially for the Christians, as Jesus came to earth. That's the New Covenant or the New Agreement. But they are connected with one another. It's not either or, it's both and. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit as we get into it, but that's the reason, and we're going to talk about authority and interpretation for Christians first, and then after the break we're going to talk about the background, structure, and form of the Old Testament. How is it made up? Where did it come from? What do we need to understand about that? Next week we will talk about the Pentateuch and Torah, the first five books of the Bible. Actually, we're going to spend 2 weeks on this because the Torah, or the books of the law, called the books of Moses, or the Pentateuch, which literally means five books, is foundational. Everybody sees that as critical understanding. Those are the most important parts of the Old Testament. It's all God's Word, but that's the part that really gives us the greatest understanding of the human condition and God's desire for us. Next week we will deal with the prologue. The first 11 chapters are called the prehistoric prologue. And there are four great events that happen in the first 11 chapters of Genesis. And I will talk about those. And the introduction of the patriarchs. The patriarchs are Adam, his son Isaac, Isaac's son Jacob, and one of Jacob's sons, Joseph, the four patriarchs. We'll talk about those next week, and then... I said Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and one of Jacob's sons, Joseph. What did I say?
Adam.
No, Abraham. Sorry. Thanks for calling me on that. See? There's a mistake. There's a slip up.
Already?
And then the next, week three, we're going to talk about the redemption and law, because when you get to the book of Exodus, and the Exodus, literally the exit, if you ever go anywhere in Greece and you see an exit sign anywhere, even though it's in Greek letters, you can read it, because the Greek letters for E-X-O-D-U-S look, you know, you can easily tell that's what they are. Exodus is the Greek word for exit. So the book of Exodus is God's redemption of the Hebrew people from captivity in Egypt, and then the giving of the law, and as you get into later on into Joshua, we will get into the entry into the Promised Land. So we'll deal with 2 weeks for the Torah. Torah means instruction or law. Instruction is probably a better word, although it's usually referred to as the law. The Pentateuch is a Greek word which means five books, because they're the books of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. So we'll spend 2 weeks on those. We then will talk about the former prophets. History in the prophets, we'll look at Joshua and Judges, the taking and establishing of the Promised Land. Then Samuel, 1 and 2, Kings, 1 and 2, the story of the monarchy. And there's a reason why I have parentheses around 1 and 2. And we'll talk about order in a minute and why this order here. On your sheet, there are page numbers. If you want to glance at the sheet that says course schedule, description, and outline, you'll notice that next week it's got page V, you know, which is before the number, through page 21. You have to read that for next week. And then before week three, and that's in this book, in the Bible maps and charts, I would strongly recommend, I am not requiring it this course, but I would strongly recommend that you also read the Bible. Duh! To take the opportunity, because you now know what we're going to be talking about. For instance, that next week you read the book of Genesis, the prologue and patriarchs, at least, and over the next 2 weeks you read all of Genesis, and then, I'm sorry, next week you read Genesis, and then after that, you read the rest of the Pentateuch, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Because if you don't actually take this information and apply it to this book, then it's just academic. I mean, this is an academic course anyway. This is not the same as Bible study. These classes are dedicated to informing you. Our intention is that you learn stuff. When we do a Bible study, the intention is we learn something, but the purpose there is really transformation. It's information for the sake of transformation. This is information for the sake of knowledge. There's a different objective in these courses than there is in a Bible study. All right? We then will continue with the latter prophets. We'll talk about prophets and prophecy, what prophecy means, the major prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Ezekiel, the minor prophets, and particularly the book of the 12 are the minor prophets. Now, major and minor doesn't mean important and unimportant. It has to do with the length of the books. The major prophets are some of the longest books in the Bible. The minor prophets are shorter books. And in fact, those 12, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi, in the Hebrew Bible, those are gathered together in one book called the Book of the 12, because there are 12 minor prophets. We then will look at the writings. And I'm going to explain what these headings mean in terms of Torah, the prophets and writings. The books of truth, Psalm, Proverbs, and Job are called the books of truth in the Hebrew Bible. And then the five scrolls, or the five megillot. Song of Songs, Ruth, Lamentations, Ecclesiastes, and Esther. These five scrolls, or special books, each one of them is read at a different major festival in the Jewish year. So these five scrolls are read at five different festivals. For example, the book of Esther is the book that led to the celebration of Purim, it's called, when the Jewish people were saved from destruction in Persia by the evil Haman. Well, what happens is when the Jewish people celebrate Purim, they will read the whole book of Esther as part of the celebration. And it's actually very fun because when they read the name Haman, the bad guy, they have these noisemakers and they drown out the sound before they say the name Haman. And the reason is because Scripture says your name will be forgotten. So they literally, you know, make it so you can't hear it when they read the name Haman. Well, each of these five scrolls, or five megillot, the Hebrew word for scrolls, is read at a different festival. Have you ever heard the expression, the whole Megillah? Megillah is the singular version of Megillot. Some of these books, it takes quite a while to read the whole book of Esther at one sitting. And so the expression, well, he did the whole Megillah, means they read the whole book, the whole scroll, if you will. That's where that expression comes from. Because at each of the festivals, they would read these five scrolls, or five Megillot. Then they have other writings, Daniel, Ezra, Nehemiah, and Chronicles, again, 1 and 2. And then on week 7, we're going to talk about foundational books, the books that are really critical to understanding and the focus there. And then week 8, the Messianic prophecy and bridge to the New Testament. So that's our plan. You have the sheets, and for those of you who just came in, if you didn't get one, we'll get them to you at the break, as to what pages you need to read, and it should be pretty clear what passages of Scripture you ideally should be reading. Okay? So, does that make sense? Any questions about that? All right. Today we want to begin with turning the page here. This paper always sticks together. I don't know what's going on. I want us to talk now about what we believe about God's Word. And those of you who've taken the new members classes will recognize a couple of slides here. On what do we as Christians base our faith? We base our faith on God's own revelation. Christianity is a revealed religion, as is Judaism, and the Muslims claim that Islam is also a revealed religion, which means it's not like some of the ancient or more primitive religions where people went out and they heard thunder and they were trying to figure out the explanation for that, and so they came up with stories about thunder gods and about, you know, gods fighting in the mountains and that sort of thing. We believe that the specifics of our faith is revealed to us by God. And there are four different levels of revelation that are in descending order of importance, reliance, authority, however you want to say that. First, we believe in the revelation of God in Scripture. That God has not been silent. He has given us His Word, this book, And so many people say, well, you know, God is so mysterious. I can't really get into God because how do you know? I mean, how do you know about God? It's such a mystery. Well, if they find God that mysterious, they have not read this book, because that's a pretty big volume where God has made a special point of letting us know who He is, what He desires, why He made us, what we are like, what concerns we need to apply to ourselves. So this is the primary source of revelation that God has given us. And it is the most authoritative, all right? So the Word of God is first. We then have the revelation of God to His church down through history. This particularly, for instance, is reflected in the creeds of the church. Now, the creeds are shorthand versions of the truth we find in Scripture. But the church, that is, with a capital C, church, not small c, meaning a local church, the church has, down through history, made determinations about how to understand the truth of God and how to reflect it and interpret it, how to worship God. We believe God has worked by His Holy Spirit through the church in order to teach us these things. And I used to teach the course for new members at University Presbyterian Church in Seattle, a course on the creeds of the Presbyterian Church. And it was required for new members. And one young man, he really had a problem with this. He said, why should I have to study these creeds? Why don't we just study the Bible? And I said, well, the creeds are an expression of the truth of the Bible. He said, then just use the Bible. It's wrong to use creeds. And I said, tell you what, why don't you stand up in church on Sunday morning and recite what you believe this whole book is telling you? The creeds are a shorthand version of the truth of Scripture that allows us to use it in worship, and personal worship and corporate worship. But the truths in there, the church has written down, are based upon what Scripture is. So it acknowledges that that's the first revelation. We also believe in God's revelation in the world, what sometimes is called general revelation. Scripture is very clear that if we're using the reason and the senses that God gave us correctly, we will see the glory of God in the beauty of His handiwork, in the stars and in the magnificence of creation. But God gave us reason. He gave us the ability to perceive things. We can use those wrong, in which case people would argue, well, you know, that demonstrates the lack of the existence of God. But if we use them right, they will point us toward God. God does reveal Himself. Scripture is very clear about that. And fourth, the revelation of God to individual people or to small groups of people. We believe, for instance, that God speaks through our session, our board of elders here in our church, about what our church ought to be doing. We believe the Holy Spirit directs us. But these four ways in which God has revealed Himself are in descending order of authority. If our board of elders, for instance, our session, were to come along and say, well, we really believe that Jesus was a great guy and a great teacher, but He wasn't really the Son of God, that's not going to fly. That's not from God, because the higher authority, which is the revelation of God in Scripture, tells us that He is the Son of God. And the church has affirmed that down through history. And so these are descending order. Ours is a revealed religion. And it is revealed to us in two parts in terms of Scripture, the most authoritative. The Old Covenant or Old Testament and the New Covenant or New Testament. And that's why we're studying this stuff. All right? At any time you've got a question, stop me, raise your hand, throw something, whatever you have to do to get my attention, okay? So what do we believe about Scripture? We believe, first off, that it is revealed. That's sort of the basis of what I was just saying. Jeremiah 32 and 3 says, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says, write in a book all the words I have spoken to you. God has given the content that is written in Scripture. The inspired revelation revealed by God. That doesn't mean that the Holy Spirit, you know, took over the writers of the Bible and made them automatons. We know that's not true, because we can tell differences in the style of writing of Paul and John, for instance. But still, it is the message that God desired and was revealed to them by Him. Secondly, we believe that all of Scripture is inspired, similar to the revelation. 2 Timothy 3 says, all Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God and woman of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. So God has inspired this book. We believe that it is authoritative, meaning it has authority over us. 1 Corinthians 15, Paul writes, for what I received I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that He was buried, that He was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter and then to the 12. The repeating chorus of according to the scriptures, that's what we base the truth on. Carolyn was present one time. We were watching a special that was Peter Jennings hosted on the Jesus Seminar. The Jesus Seminar is an ultra-liberal group of Protestant theologians who, they literally got together and voted on what parts of the Bible they thought Jesus, of the Gospels, Jesus really said and what he didn't really say. You know, they did it with colored stones, either black or white stones. And they ended up deciding about 80% of what the Bible says Jesus said he never had anything to do with. Well, in watching this special where they were interviewing the Jesus Seminar guys, one of them said, well, the Gospels say this. And then he sort of looked off in the distance and said, but I prefer to believe that. And he went on in some crazy kind of interpretation for which he had no basis to say, the Bible says this, but I prefer to believe this, and to present it as a supposed scholar? No. You know, Carolyn will tell you, I used some riper words than I should have at the TV screen that night over these, the presumption, the pride of these guys. Well, we believe that the Bible is authoritative. You don't just pick something else that you like better than it, okay? And we believe that Scripture is living. Hebrews says, for the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. How many of you have ever read something in Scripture that you have read many times before, and yet for some reason you find something in it, or it touches something in you, it gives you a message that you had never picked up before, that applies to where you are right now? That's what I believe it means when it says that it is living, that even though the words on the paper may be the same, God, the Holy Spirit, adapts it in a very living way to touch us where we need to be touched at any given time, that it will adapt itself to what our needs are, and so we believe it is a living thing. And you'll notice all of these are scripture verses that I'm using as the basis for this stuff. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Where it says, it penetrates even dividing soul and spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So that means like it's a very powerful flashlight inside to see which things are of the spirit, which are like just like doctors do now, they put out an endoscopy mm-hmm. with a light. Just, it can tell very well what's happening with you, with
right.
your spirit, with your soul, and with your physical body. So
right.
that's what it is.
Well, I think very similar to that. We could get into discussions of bipartite versus tripartite, you know, nature of humanity kind of stuff. We'll do that right now. But yes, the authority of Scripture is that it knows us. You know, it is the Word of God written, and that it can apply itself to us in various circumstances in different times because it has the wisdom of the Lord behind it, and the Holy Spirit uses it. It is a tool in the hands of the Holy Spirit to apply to our lives. Okay? All right, let's go on. So, why study the Old Testament? As I said, there are some Christians, some Christian ministers even, who don't believe that the Old Testament should be focused on by Christians. That we are given the New Testament, the New Covenant. We don't need to worry about the Old Covenant. Well, I think that's heresy. And let's talk about why. First, we need to recognize that the scriptures that are referred to in the New Testament, with one exception, are always the Old Testament. Whenever it says scripture, it's talking about the Old Testament. 2 Peter 3:16, Peter writes that, it's kind of a funny statement, he says, our brother Paul is kind of hard to understand sometimes, but some of the letters he has written has been given by God. So that's the only place we have in the New Testament that seems to indicate that some of the earliest writing, which is Paul, was already beginning to be accepted as being canon. I'll explain that in a little while. In other words, the Word of God to us by the time, you know, when Paul and Peter were still alive. But every other reference, they're talking about the Old Testament. When you read the sermons of Paul, he's quoting the Old Testament in order to demonstrate how Jesus is the fulfillment of that. Peter, the great sermon in the second chapter of Acts, and then later where he had 5,000 and 3,000 converted, he's quoting from the Old Testament to show how Jesus is the fulfillment of messianic expectation. the story of the martyrdom, the sermon of Stephen, the first Christian martyr before he's martyred. Everything Stephen is talking about is from the Old Testament as an argument for the Messiahship of Jesus. And most of you all know that I do work with Messianic Christian, or Jewish Christian organizations, in other words, Messianic Jews. And their whole ministry to Jewish people is to look at the Hebrew Bible, the Tanakh, and explain how that points directly to the reality of Jesus as the Messiah. And so when we read Scripture in the New Testament, it doesn't mean Paul's writings or John's writings or anything else. It means the writing of the Old Testament. And I think that that's critically important. When Jesus is talking about, at one point when he's criticizing some of the apostles, he said, you don't even know the law and the prophets. Well, law, prophets, and writings are the way that the Hebrew Bible is referred to, because those are the three sections. In another place, Jesus said, you need to look to the law of the prophets and the Psalms. Psalms was kind of an abbreviation for the third category, which is writings, because Psalms was the longest book, and it was the one that was best known. And so law, prophets, and writings, as we're going to talk about in just a minute, are the three sections of the Hebrew Bible. And so Jesus referred to the fact that that's where truth was to be found. Who are we to say that we shouldn't be doing that? We also need to recognize that the Old Testament is part of God's inspired revelation to us. God gave this to us. We don't just decide that it's not relevant for us anymore. Jesus was very clear. He didn't say, I come to do away with the law. What did he say? I come to fulfill the law. Jesus made a specific point of saying that his focus was to use the law for our benefit. It is part of the inspired revelation to us. And Jesus talks about that a lot. The Emmaus Road experience. When Jesus is, after his resurrection, he's walking along and two of the disciples don't recognize him. He's apparently hidden his identity. And he's talking to them about the events in Jerusalem. And in Luke 24 it says, he said to them, how foolish you are and how slow to believe all the prophets have spoken. He's talking about leading up to Jesus now. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures, that's Old Testament, concerning himself. So Jesus was very specific about that. That it is God's revelation to us, and the revelation points to Jesus. And we need to recognize that and study the Old Testament too. We also believe that the Old Testament is foundational for our understanding. It's written for us and for our benefit. I don't think we can understand God's plan for humanity without a knowledge of the Old Testament. The first 11 chapters of the book of Genesis, for instance, which you're supposed to be reading, you should read that for next week, and also probably you must read the passages in the Nelson book if you're taking this for credit. The first section, first 11 chapters of Genesis, tells us how we came into existence, how it is that evil and sin came into the world, what God's plan was to do about it, why people speak different languages, why there's so much misunderstanding in the world. All of those things are in the first 11 chapters. Well, if we don't know where we came from, what our problem is, what God had started from the very first to do to address those problems, then how can we say that we have an understanding of what God's desire is for us? All of that is Old Testament stuff. That's just in the first 11 chapters, which we're going to talk about in more detail next week. The doctrine of the creation is a foundational doctrine that tells us what our relationship is from the start to God, that He is our Creator God, we are His creation. You sever that tie and don't believe that God is the Creator, you don't focus on that part of the Old Testament, and we lose our anchor in that. Creation and redemption are the two great pillars of doctrine that are in the Christian faith. Okay, the Jewish faith as well, for that matter. So we have to pay attention. The doctrines of sin and the fall, of covenant, of redemption and salvation, all of those are fundamental to our understanding, and all of them are in the Old Testament. Okay? Make sense? Then the Old Testament is practical. It is eminently practical. There's a lot of great wisdom in there. Several years ago now, I did a long series of sermons here called the Real People series, in which I started in Genesis and I took people and the stories of the people in the Old Testament and talked about, excuse me, what we learned from them, why we were given those stories, the practical training that we receive from all of that. In the book of Genesis, as I said, we were taught what we are, where we came from, and what's wrong with us. Very practical. The book of Job is the ultimate essay of all time about human suffering. People who are not religious will look to the book of Job to try to understand the nature of suffering and what to do about it. The book of Psalms teaches us about praising and worshiping God. It's the book of praise. Proverbs and Ecclesiastes teach us what wisdom is and how we can find it. And on and on. There are very practical kinds of applications in the Old Testament books. Also, we need to recognize that the Old Testament does point to Jesus Christ. There is very clearly, and you know, a quote I read from Jesus a minute ago, saying that the prophets, the Old Testament writings, pointed to the Messiah. And that is the ministry, the most effective ministry to Jewish people today in bringing them to faith in Christ, is to show them how the Hebrew Bible points to the Messiah. Now, we have to be careful here. Our faith is rooted in Jesus Christ. It is rooted in our belief in the Messiah, no question about that. But we also need, from a particularly an academic point of view, we need to have an appreciation for the fact that the Hebrew Bible had an application and a set of meaning for the Hebrew people even before Jesus came. Norman Geisler is a theologian, and I appreciate a lot of his work, especially in apologetics. He has a book on Old Testament theology, which I like except for one thing, is that he'll talk about the Old Testament theology, and then in every point, he will refer it to Jesus. He'll connect it to Jesus. And I think there's a point at which we also have to appreciate the Old Testament for what it tells us about God's relationship with the Hebrew people before even Jesus arrived. But it does point to Jesus. I'll give you a couple of quotes here. E.F. Ellis, in his book, Paul's Use of the Old Testament, says, "For Paul," that is the Apostle Paul, "Christ was not only a factor giving added meaning to the Old Testament, but was the only means whereby the Old Testament could be rightly understood. It was not merely that he saw Christ in the Old Testament, but that he viewed the whole scope of the Old Testament prophecy and history from the standpoint of the Messianic age in which the Old Testament stood open, fulfilled in Jesus Christ and in his new creation." Jesus ties up all the loose ends, in effect. One of the books that I've used a lot, but again, it costs like $40, and so it's not the one I've chosen for our Old Testament theology classes, is a book by William Sanford Lasore, Fred Bush, and David Allen Hubbard. I think it's a great book, and I especially like it because Fred Bush was one of my Old Testament professors. David Allen Hubbard was the president of the seminary when I was there, and William Sanford Lasore retired the year before I went to seminary, so his presence was still kind of there. In their book on Old Testament theology, they write this: "In study, as in worship, humankind meets the entire revelation, the whole Bible. The Old Testament belongs not to the Jewish people alone, but to all. It is the account of the ways in which God has worked. It is the summary of what he has demanded. It is the record of his preparation for Christ's coming. It is the best canvas on which to catch the picture of his dealings with the human family down through the centuries." I like that, the human family, not just the Jews, all of us. "In short, it is the indispensable foundation on which the New Testament is built." Well, in the same way that you can't have any sort of meaningful building without a foundation, it's certainly not going to be able to support itself, if we're going to have a real understanding of the New Testament, we have to have the foundation of the Old Testament to support it. And that's why this class is taught first. All right? Any questions about any of those reasons why we as Christians should be studying the Old Testament?
I have a question.
Sure.
Okay, so there were all these Jews. And then when Jesus came and the Jews didn't accept him, and then the Christians did, what were the Christians before they were Christians?
They were Jews, all of them.
Okay, that's what I wanted to know.
Yeah, when people say the Jews wouldn't accept him, the Jewish authorities wouldn't accept him, but all of the early Christians were Jews. Jesus was a Jew. Paul was a Jew. Peter was a Jew. All of the apostles were Jews. All of the early disciples were Jews.
Luke
is the only writer of the New Testament, or of anything, the whole Bible. Look at the whole Bible. Luke is the only Gentile writer of anything. All of the rest were Jewish. Luke wrote Acts, the book of Luke and the book of Acts. But he did so after being a disciple, if you will, of Paul. And so, and interviewing all these Jewish people. The Gospel of Luke is written after he spoke to all of the Jewish people who had known Jesus and gives that account. That's how he introduces it.
What did the people that weren't Jewish believe in?
They were pagans. They believed in the Greek and Roman gods.
Yeah.
Or others. I mean, there were other, there were mystery religions. Egypt still had its own religion in that day. So there were other kinds of pagan beliefs. But prior to Christianity, the only monotheistic religion that had existed was Judaism. It's both the oldest one, because Abraham was quite early, all right, 2000 BC. Abraham came even before. People often say, well, the Egyptians were monotheistic at one point. Well, there was one king, Akhenaten, one pharaoh, who was Thutmose IV, who took the name Akhenaten, who tried to advocate for a belief in one god, the god Aten. That's why he's called Akhenaten. But it only lasted for a short time during his life, and when he died, they went back to the old way of worshiping multiple gods because nobody wanted that. That was after Abraham, though. Judaism is even older than that. So the idea was the only monotheistic religion that existed was Judaism, and Christianity is an offshoot of Judaism. Scripture is very clear about that. We are all honorary Jews. Paul says we are grafted, we are a branch grafted onto the rootstock of the Jewish people. We are heirs to the promise. We got adopted into the family so that we could be part of the inheritance that God had promised to the Jewish people. But all of the early Christians were all Jews. All, with the exception of Luke, all of the Bible is written by Jewish people. It wasn't until Cornelius, the Roman centurion, and his family, under the ministry of Peter, accepted the gospel, and then later some of the Gentiles in Antioch, when Paul and Barnabas were there, but at the start, all of them were Jews.
But even in the Bible, they talk about worshiping Baal. Even the Jews at some point.
Well, the Jews, yeah, that's the reason why they were constantly being judged, is because they would fail to worship the one true God. They would betray their relationship with him and go after other gods.
But then Solomon, I think, whenever it feels this Baal, you know, they mention it quite a few out of time.
Oh, yeah, there's a lot of it. In fact,
Bible. It wasn't, and I don't even remember any other one being mentioned. It was always Baal.
Well, and they talk about the Baals, plural, because there were more than one deity as part of that religion. That's sort of a generic word. There's references to Dagon, to Molech. These were other gods of that time.
I want to say Asherah poles?
Well, the Asherah poles, they often will talk about the Baals and Asherah. That was the female deity in the Baal religion.
Do you say Baal? I always thought it was Baal.
Well, when they talk about the plural, it's hard to say Baals, it's plural, so Baals makes more sense, okay? There were other multiple gods, and the Jews, apparently, their girls were prettier, and so they'd wander off after those other religions. That's what got Solomon in trouble. Solomon married all these women who were worshippers of foreign gods, and he not only allowed them to continue to worship those gods, he actually supported it. He built places for human sacrifice so that his wives could continue to worship their deities. And as punishment, God had promised he would not remove Solomon. As long as he was alive, he would continue to sit on the throne of his father David. But when Solomon died, the kingdom got split in two, and that was the punishment for Solomon's allowing that to happen. Okay? All right. Let's talk now about some of the kind of background and structure. This chart, which you probably can't read from back there, but this is all of the Bible. There are 66 books in the Protestant Bible, okay? Note that I say in the Protestant Bible. That's broken up into what we call the Old Testament or Old Covenant, which is 39 books, and the New Testament or New Covenant, which is 27 books. Grace Contratus, the first time I did this course, she said, you know how you can remember how many books? She said, because Old Testament, Old is 3 letters and Testament is 9 letters. So there's 39 books in the Old Testament. With the New Testament, it's 3 and 9. So multiply them together and you get 27. That's how many books are in the New Testament. All right. So 66 total. And according to the Protestant designations, the Old Testament is broken up in 4 sections. The books of the law, which I already mentioned, the 5 books of Moses, also called the Torah, which is the Hebrew word for law or instruction. The Pentateuch, the 5 books, there's a lot of different names for this. It's the most important section of the Hebrew Bible. Then the books of history, 12 books, from Joshua to Esther. This is the way Protestants delineate it, not Jews. We'll talk about that. Then the books of wisdom, the five books, Job, Psalm, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Song of Songs. And then the books of prophecy. There are the five major prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, and Daniel. Lamentations is not a prophet. It's written by the prophet Jeremiah. And then the 12, the minor prophets. New Testament, of course, four Gospels and the book of Acts. There are the letters of Paul and then the general epistles, together making 21 letters, and then the book of Revelation. So this is how the Protestants structure the Bible. And you'll notice this is the order it's in. It starts with Genesis in the Old Testament and goes to Malachi, right? That here's another way to see that. It's a little bit bigger. Five books of law, 12 books of history, five books of wisdom, five books of the prophets, and 12 books, major prophets, and 12 books of the minor prophets. So 39 books total in the Old Testament or Old Covenant, right? Now, that's how Protestants see it. That is not the way the Jewish Bible was originally laid out. This is the same thing. 39 books, four sections. Law, history, wisdom, and prophecy. The prophecy books, Isaiah through Malachi, sometimes are broken up into major prophets, which, as I say, are just the longer ones, and minor prophets, Isaiah through Malachi, which are the book of the 12, according to the Hebrews. All right, now, this is how the Jews see the Hebrew Bible. And, by the way, I should have mentioned as well, when we talk about the Hebrew or the Greek New Testament, the all of the Bible, we refer to that as the canon of Scripture. Not C-A-N-N-O-N, no. It's C-A-N-O-N. It is from a Greek word, kanon, which in Greek architecture was a straight, unbendable rod, sort of like our modern yardsticks, that was used in construction, and it was set at an established length so that they knew whether things were the right, you know, were being measured correctly. So it quite literally means it's a ruler. And canon was the word that came to be meant the symbol for truth and accuracy. So it was applied to the Bible, to Scripture. The Scripture is referred to as canon. When they say that, they mean this is God's word to us. This is not just somebody's ideas. It is the measuring rod that God has given us. And so when we talk about all of Old and New Testament, it is the canon. Galatians 6:16 even says, peace and mercy to all who follow this rule, canon, even to the Israel of God. All right? So, we've talked about the way Protestants see those books, but that's not the way the Hebrews see their Bible. In the Hebrew Bible, there are three sections. There is the law, five books, that's the same. Torah, Pentateuch, whatever name you want to use, there's several different names for it. Then there are eight books of the prophets. In Hebrew, Torah means law or instruction. Prophet is Nevi'im. And I'll tell you in a second why that's important. You're going to learn Hebrew in this class too. And then there are 11 books that are called the books of the writings, or Ketuvim in Hebrew. So Torah, five books, the eight books of the prophets, Nevi'im, and 11 books of writings, or Ketuvim. The Hebrews take those three words, Torah, Nevi'im, and Ketuvim, shorten them and push them together, and come up with the word Tanakh, which is the standard word that the Hebrew people, the Jewish people, use for their Hebrew Bible. You will hear them refer to the Tanakh. That's the same as our Old Testament. It is the Hebrew Bible. Sometimes they will refer to it as the Mikra, which means that which is read, because a big part of the Jewish tradition is to read Scripture out loud. And so the Mikra, that which is read, or the Tanakh. Now, you will notice that there's only 24 books here. Didn't we just say there are 39 books in the Bible? Well, it's exactly the same material, but it's organized differently. Hi, we've got some chairs over here, if you'd like, or over there. The books of the Torah, the first five books, are the same. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. But then the prophets, or Nevi'im in Hebrew, are Joshua, Judges, Samuel, 1 and 2, Kings, 1 and 2, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and then the book of the 12, which is the minor prophets. Now, the thing is here, careful of the tripod.
Yes.
Well, yeah. It's exactly the same material, but it's organized differently. And they don't have, when we put parentheses around 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, that's Samuel is one book in the Hebrew Bible. Kings is one book. Chronicles is one book. Ezra and Nehemiah are put together as one book. And the 12 minor prophets are one book called the Book of the 12. So even though it's the same amount of material, instead of calling it 39 books, they call it 24 books. And it's in a different order. In fact, it's in this order. The writings include the books of truth, Psalm, Proverbs, and Job. But then the five scrolls, the Song of Songs, or Song of Solomon, we sometimes call it. It's the same book. Song of Songs is actually the right translation for it. Ruth, Lamentations, Ecclesiastes, and Esther. I told you those are the scrolls that they read at the five major festivals. Then other writings. It's like, okay, and then we've got the rest of this. It's sort of like Gilligan's Island, you know, the professor, instead of saying Professor Marianne, it used to be, and the rest. That's sort of what Daniel, Ezra, Nehemiah, and Chronicles. Oh, you guys know Gilligan's Island. Come on. Now, because Daniel is not really the Hebrews don't see it as a prophetic book. They see it as an apocalyptic book. And part of it, it's very different because part of it is written in a different language. Part of it's written in Aramaic. And part of it in Hebrew. It's the only book that's got any significant portion written in any language other than Hebrew in the Hebrew Bible. Ezra Nehemiah is sort of a history book. It's sort of a prophecy book. It's the fulfillment of God's plan. And Chronicles 1 and 2. Chronicles is exactly the same content, basically, as Kings, 1 and 2 Kings. The difference is, Chronicles is written from a very formal point of view. It's like every king, every court, would have a chronicler that was responsible for keeping track of the official events having to do with the kingdom and the king's reign. And so Chronicles has got the same events, but much more staid, much more formal and proper. But it's the same content, so they put it at the end. The Hebrew Bible ends with Chronicles, not with Malachi. Malachi comes up under the Nevi'im, under the minor prophets, the latter prophets. Okay, same material, grouped differently and in a different order. But the Hebrew Bible and the Protestant Bible are the same other than that. Make sense?
Why did the Protestants change?
Why do we do things like that? I think that we like to think of it in terms of, well, these books are primarily historical, and so we came up with our own designations. Why did we put the New Testament in the order that it's in? The books of Paul are all together, but they're not in the order Paul wrote them. The first book that Paul wrote was Galatians, and then 1 Thessalonians. We have Romans first. Do you know why?
It's longest.
The letters of Paul are from the longest, Romans, to the shortest, and Philemon. And who thought that was a good idea? But once it was done and we started having it in that order, try changing it now, okay? You very well can't. So in terms of Protestants, we have to do it our own way. And so it was changed. Now the Catholic Bible has the same order as the Protestant Bible, but it adds some books. The Apocrypha. And I'm going to talk about the Apocrypha a little bit later on. But there are seven actually, additional books in the Catholic Bible that were added later. Okay. I want to do one more thing, and then we're going to take a break here, all right? To give you an idea of the history, just very roughly, and again, all of this stuff is online. If you want to go on and look at this stuff again, just go to litchapala.org, and all of this is on there. If you look at the books of the Hebrew Bible, and by the way, I'm going to be following in this course more the Hebrew model of, if you look at the outline that I gave you earlier, and I'll give you all copies in just a minute, of the class, I'm following according to Torah, Nevi'im, Ketuvim, you know, the law, the prophets, and the writings, the way it was originally presented, not the way we're used to it. And so that'll involve some jumping around if you're reading passages in your Bible. But if we look at the books of the law and the books of history, primarily, Adam and Eve, sometime longer than 4,000 years ago, and I'm not going to get into that right now. We can, you know, come back to the philosophical theology class when we do it. But long time ago, Abraham was around 2,000 BC. We believe the oldest books of the Bible are Job and Genesis. Job probably was written at the time of Abraham or earlier, so it's probably the first of the books. The other wisdom books came quite early as well, which is why the part in red over here, which lists the books. So we've got Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and then Joseph, the fourth of the patriarchs, dies around 1804 BC. I should put circas in there. And then Moses around 1500, the Exodus around 1440. Psalms were written during the time of David and others. David wrote the majority, more than half the Psalms, but not all of them. We also get Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Song of Songs, or Song of Solomon, in here during the time of Solomon. So that gives you sort of an idea where those books are. And then the books of the law and the books of history were written, books of the law written by Moses, as traditionally believed. We'll talk about that next week. During this time period, then the books of history, starting with Joshua, sometime after 1400, all right? Up until the last of the prophets, which was Malachi, was in the 400s. So that gives you some idea, kind of the history. And remember, Abraham lived before Akhenaten. So Abraham, the revelation of Abraham, was the first monotheistic revelation. Now, I say that, there are more and more historical sociologists and anthropologists who are beginning to say that humanity may have begun as monotheists and then degraded into polytheism and then came back. That it used to be that the belief was all human beings have been polytheists up until Abraham, and then monotheism was a new invention. But more and more there's an indication that there may have been a monotheism that existed first, and then we ended up falling away from that and losing our sensitivity or our belief in one God and believing instead of many different forces that we thought were divine. So we'll talk about that. Okay, let's take a break. I want to talk for a while now about how the Old Testament came to us. Now that may sound like an obvious thing. We're so used to permanence in materials. It's like, well, you know, if Moses wrote the first five books of the Bible, then he made enough photocopies to distribute to everybody, and then he kept the originals on his hard drive, and it was easy, right? Well, not so much. I want to talk about the process by which we ended up with the Bible as we have today, and particularly we're talking about the Old Testament. But first, let's talk about the original Hebrew documents. It's possible that the book of Job may be older even than 1450 or so. It may be as old as Abraham, back to 2000 BC. But we believe that the traditional view is that, which I hold to, is that Moses wrote the first five books of the Hebrew Bible, which would be the Torah, the Pentateuch, called the books of Moses often. More liberal scholars question that because, for instance, one of the things that we get into in the Pentateuch is that the story is told of Moses' death and burial. And, well, how does that work, you know, if Moses wrote it? Well, there's a couple of different options there. Either it could have been that he was given a revelation of what his death was going to be, or, I think even more likely, there are places where other divinely ordained writers have contributed. For instance, Joshua, who was the assistant and follower of Moses, also ordained by God and had been righteous since a young age because he was one of the two spies who went into the promised land and said, yes, we can do this. By God's power, we can take this land. When the other ten said, no, we can't. And so it's very possible that Joshua, still under the direction of God, would add the section about Moses' death. There is nothing about that that is problematic. It's still seeing it as primarily authored by Moses, the first five books. So Moses was around 1450 BC. We believe that in that period of time, 1450 to 1400, was the traditional date for the Exodus and for the eventual entry into the Promised Land. Now, again, it's a very complicated thing how these writings came down to us, because you have to know something about the medium that was carried on. First, they didn't have paper. They couldn't go to, you know, Office Depot and buy our 500 sheet ream of something. For the longest time, writing was done, either they had to chisel it in stone, not very portable, it takes a long time, or they had to, they used a process called cuneiform, which is they would take a block of stone or tile, cover it with a soft clay, and then they had a wedged-shaped thing that they would use in their languages. You can see this in ancient, some of the ancient Mesopotamian cultures. They had alphabets made out of wedge shapes. But carrying around a bunch of stones with soft clay on them, not a great idea. And so there was, the Egyptians finally solved this problem of having a less expensive and more portable kind of writing when they discovered papyrus. Papyrus, how many of y'all have seen papyrus? Okay, if you go to the Middle East, you can buy, you know, paintings on papyrus and stuff now. Papyrus is a reed that grows in Egypt along the banks of the Nile. They take this papyrus, they cut it and split it, and lay it out flat and sort of hammer it flat, and they'll put strips of it vertically and then strips of it horizontally, press it together, and it sticks to itself, and it makes something that looks sort of like onion skin paper, if you know what that is, except it's a yellow color. And it's great. In fact, it was so practical that when the horizontal pieces of the papyrus were laid on there, it's almost like lined notebook paper. You know, it gave you a line that you could write on. Of course, it was this way, because languages back then tended to be from right to left. And papyrus was great, cheap, easy to make, relatively speaking, and portable. The problem is it's an organic material, which means if it gets wet, it rots. And if it gets too dry, it crumbles. And so it didn't last very long. The other, much later, like 300 BC, this was discovered thousands of years ago, papyrus. And by the Egyptians, one of the most ancient of all cultures. And so papyrus was used, but it never lasted very long. And during that period of history, up until the printing press, Gutenberg and the printing press, every culture had, as one of their most important professions, the profession of scribes. You read about scribes, you know, Pharisees and scribes. The scribes were the people who were taught to read and write, and their job was to write stuff down. And even more importantly, to copy stuff, because when these papyrus started to decay or started to wear thin, they would copy them over onto a new one. And then when that started wearing out, they'd have to copy it again. That was what the scribes did. And so there was a long history of this writing and rewriting kinds of stuff. Later on, about 300 BC, they developed parchment. Parchment is animal skin that has been not tanned, you know, like leather that we use in shoes and stuff, but has simply been scraped so that all of the gooey material comes off of it, and you've just got the layer. If you've ever been in a museum and you've seen this kind of wrinkly white stuff that ancient documents are on, it looks sort of onion paper except it's thicker, that's vellum, or that's parchment. Parchment is animal skin that's been scraped. The very best kind is called vellum, which is calf skin. Vellum literally means calf. Right? And so they would use animal skins for this. But even that's organic, and ultimately those things, you know, can be destroyed, they can rot, different things can happen to them. They're not very permanent, and there was no kind of permanent storage. So what happened was, over the centuries, we have people rewriting this stuff and rewriting it, trying to come up with more permanent ways to keep it. But for the oldest documents, whether you're talking about Old Testament or New Testament, we have no original documents. They don't exist because all of the early stuff was written on materials that didn't last. They couldn't last. They were inherently volatile, to use the word. You know, they would rot or dry up and blow away. So through the centuries, these things have been copied over. Now, liberal scholars have been saying for a long, long time, well, you know, that what we have today is probably nothing like what the original documents were. That it's been added to and taken away from, and people have changed stuff, and I don't like that, so when I rewrite it, I'm going to change something, or I want to make a note of the fact that nobody should eat pastrami for lunch because it gives you gas, or whatever else it is. They've added all this stuff. Well, that was the common liberal idea until the finding of the Dead Sea Scrolls, which are the most ancient extant documents today. I'm going to talk about it in a minute. And we discovered that some of which are 400 BC, you know, 400 years before the time of Christ, And what they say is virtually identical. There are no major changes between those and what we have more modern. And so they had to completely change the idea that well, this has been changed so many times. Any changes that had been made, any variations, were very minor. It might be an abbreviation. Instead of the saying doctor, it was DR period. Or, you know, a letter added here or there. But nothing that would affect the meaning at all. Yes?
I was just wondering what the Dead Sea Scrolls were written on.
I'll talk about that. They were written primarily on papyrus. There are some metal plates that they would scratch into, but there's a reason why they survived.
Because I saw them in Houston. They brought them in Houston at one point.
They still looked pretty crumbly, didn't they?
Well, they looked pretty good.
Yeah.
So that's why I was kind of wondering what they were.
Yeah, well, there was a unique reason why they survived when almost nothing else did. We'll talk about that in just a minute. So the most ancient of the Hebrew documents were 1450 to 400 BC. These are the documents that led to that are part of the Hebrew Bible, okay? Then we have, strangely enough, one of the most accurate and important of the ancient sources we have for the Old Testament is not written in Hebrew. It's written in Greek. Because in the 4th century BC, Alexander the Great rampaged through most of the known world and conquered pretty much everything, all right? He controlled everything from modern-day, what we call Greece. He was Macedonian, which is now part, you know, northern part of Greece. And all the way over as far as India. He wanted to go all the way to the Pacific Ocean. And when he got that far, after 10 years of campaigning, he conquered Egypt. He conquered the Middle East. He conquered, you know, Afghanistan and Iraq and Iran and all the way to India. He wanted to go to the ocean. And his troops, after 10 years of campaigning, went, Al, can we please go home? This is enough already. So they started home, and he died on the way home. Okay, but because he had conquered most of the known world, and he was fanatical about Greek culture and language, he was Macedonian. They had their own language, but they also spoke Greek, since they're close by. He loved the Greek legends. He saw himself as a reincarnation of Achilles. And so he, at first, forced people to speak Greek and to pursue Greek culture. And for the Jews, you know, Greek culture included sporting events where men wrestled naked. You know, for the Jews, that was horrendous. You just don't do that. But everybody was speaking Greek, starting in the 4th century B.C. By the 3rd century B.C., the Hebrew Jewish people, you know, who had spoken the Hebrew language, and remember, their Bible's written in Hebrew, you know, the Hebrew Bible, many of them had forgotten how to read Hebrew. They only read and spoke Greek now, because it had become so dominant. And so, in the 3rd century, a little over 100 years after Alexander came through, the Jewish people decided we have to translate the Hebrew Bible into Greek so that our own people can read it, the ones who can't read Hebrew anymore. And there were parties, actually, that advocated in favor of the Greek culture or in favor of the Hebrew culture. So, in the 3rd century B.C., 70 scholars, according to tradition, came from Jerusalem down to Alexandria in Egypt, which at that point was the second biggest city in the Mediterranean basin, the known world. And they came down there because the resources were there. You know about the Library of Alexandria? Mm-hmm. Was the greatest repository of knowledge and writing in history, and it lasted up until the time of Cleopatra, at which time it was burned. You know, you've watched the movie Cleopatra, and she says, they're burning my library. Well, they did. But all of that was still there in the 3rd century B.C., and so the scholars went to Alexandria. By the way, that's only one of about 20 different cities that Alexander named after itself. He also named a city after his horse, Bucephalus. It was Bucephopolis. But they went down to Alexandria, these 70 scholars, and they translated the Hebrew Bible into Greek. It's called the Septuagint because Septua is the Greek word for 70. And the tradition is there were 70 scholars, or 72, depending on which version you look at. And they had access to documents, Hebrew documents, that are older than anything we have today, with the possible exception of some of the Dead Sea Scrolls. So for that reason, the Greek translation in the 3rd century before Christ, the Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible is in many ways the most accurate that we have. In fact, the Catholic Church for a long time believed that it was divinely inspired, and the Orthodox churches of the East still believe the Septuagint is the inspired version of the Bible. even though it's a translation from the original Hebrew, that is the Old Testament, Septuagint. So, very, very powerful, very significant. It's still true that the Septuagint is a major source for modern translators. See, nowadays, they take all the sources. They take the Dead Sea Scrolls, they take the Septuagint, versions of the original Hebrew. They'll look at all of that stuff in order to determine what is the best and most accurate version according to the original. But back then, you know, they didn't have quite that range of access. But the Septuagint Greek version of the Hebrew Bible is one of the most important and authoritative sources we have because it's simply so old. Right? Make sense? You'll stop me if you have questions. We then have the Masoretic text. We jump ahead now from the 3rd century BC to the 7th to the 11th century AD. There were a group of scholars starting in the 7th century and lasting for about 400 years that worked primarily in Israel, in the cities of Jerusalem and Tiberias. Walt just told me they're going to be in Tiberias next week. So in Jerusalem and Tiberias, and then also one location in Iraq, or what was then Babylonia. And they were in the process of trying to come up with an authoritative version of the Hebrew, to translate it back into Hebrew. They said, okay, it's enough with just the Greek version of the Hebrew Bible. We need to have an updated and accurate Hebrew version of the Hebrew Bible. So using the Septuagint and some other sources that they had, they retranslated it and came up with the Masoretic text, which has become to the Jewish people the authoritative text today. Now, there's a reason why it's considered the authoritative text, particularly, and that is because it includes vocalizations and cantillations. So you can understand why that would be more important. What does that mean? Okay. This is what that means.
No.
The red and blue dots and lines are the Masorah, which means the traditions. These are the traditional ways to understand the Hebrew text. And the Masoretes, the scholars who did this, added these vowel points and cantillation. Now let me explain what that means. Hebrew, which like a lot of ancient languages, Arabic today, for instance, reads from right to left. You know, so you start here straight across. These black letters, those are Hebrew letters. And I forget what this says, and I'd have to go back and work on it because my Hebrew is not that good anymore. But written Hebrew, like virtually all ancient languages, written Hebrew does not use any vowels. Because vowels are breathing sounds. Vowels are the things that tell you how to pronounce something. A, E, A, O, U. But to write it down, you don't need vowels. And you would simply need to learn how you pronounce the different things. And so these black letters are all consonants. But because Hebrew, the Hebrew scripture especially, was often read, and they needed to teach young people, young boys, to read the scripture in public, that's what a bar mitzvah primarily was. It was a recognition that a boy at age 13 had achieved manhood, and the primary way to show that is to stand before the congregation and to read from the Hebrew Bible. Well, in order for them to learn how to pronounce these words, they had to know what vowels rightly went in there, because the written language didn't have the vowels. The red dots and lines are called vowel points. They're sort of like Braille, except they indicate which vowels go in between these consonants. So that when a young Jewish boy was learning to read and he's coming along and he sees the consonants, the Masoretic texts give him the vowels so that he knows how to pronounce that word until he learns how to pronounce that word. The blue lines here that look sort of like accent marks are exactly that. Those are cantillations. Do you know what a cantor is? A cantor is someone, if you've been in an Episcopal church, a high Episcopal church or a Catholic church, they may have had a cantor. Jewish churches have cantors. They would sing the scripture, all right? You know, blessed is the man that walks not in the way of the ungodly, that kind of thing. So they would sing the scripture. Well, there's a right way and a wrong way to do that. You have to know where to go up and where to go down. The cantillation marks, the blue, are an indication for a cantor, that's why they're called cantillation, as to how to sing this in a service. So the vowel points and the cantillation marks were included by the Masoretic scholars, and it was such a great benefit that this became the authoritative text for the Hebrew Bible. All right? Now again, this was written pretty late, 7th to the 11th centuries A.D. That's after Jesus. Yes, Betty?
Who decided on the vowels?
Well, there,
which vowels?
Yeah, there was a tradition. I mean, that they knew from use what that was. They primarily were concerned about somebody who was learning Hebrew, learning to read Hebrew, like a young boy who's preparing for his bar mitzvah, or someone who was just beginning to study Hebrew. It was an aid for them as well. But the fact is that we, there are some Hebrew words we still don't know how to pronounce. When Israel was founded in the late 1940s, Hebrew was a dead language. It was like Latin. And unlike Latin, which does have vowels written into it, there were words in Hebrew we did not know how to pronounce.
Like Yahweh?
Like Yahweh. Yahweh, we only assume we know what the vowels in that are. Yahweh being the proper name of God. And the transliteration is YHWH, four consonants. And then the decision was that it most likely the vowel sounds would be A-A. So YAHWEH is how we pronounce Yahweh. But we don't know for sure that that's right. And for a special reason. But because Hebrew was a dead language, the government of Israel decided they were going to resurrect the Hebrew language and make it a living language again. And every linguist in the world said, you can't do that. That's never been done. It's not possible. You can't do it. Well, they did it. But in the process, they had to decide how you pronounce some of these things. And they did. But to give you an idea of the complications of the vowel points, you all know the word Jehovah. Right? You may have heard me say this before. There is no such word as Jehovah. It's not that there's anything wrong with it. I'm not having a problem with it. But because when the Jewish boys were learning to read Scripture, the Hebrew Bible, and they came to Yahweh, the four-consonant name, the Tetragrammaton it's called, the four-letter name of God, the Jews were ordered not to take the Lord's name in vain. And they said, well, to make sure we never make that mistake even accidentally, we are never going to pronounce the name of God. So when a Hebrew boy was taught, when he got to the name Yahweh in the Hebrew Bible, he was told, you should instead of Yahweh, the proper name of God, you should say Adonai, which means Lord. And so what happens is, if you take the consonants from Yahweh, and the vowels, because they put the vowel points in there for Adonai to remind him, you don't say Yahweh, you say Adonai. The consonants from Yahweh and the vowel points from Adonai make Jehovah. And that's where we get that word. Again, I don't have a huge problem with it, but that's because of the whole vowel point thing. Okay? So this was the Masoretic text. And it became the authoritative Jewish scripture. Now, next in our studies, there are other sources, things like the Samaritan Pentateuch. Remember, the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Hebrew Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. The Samaritans, you know, the story of the Good Samaritan, the Samaritan woman at the well, the Samaritans were people who had lived in the northern kingdom of Israel. It was the southern kingdom of Judah. And in 722, the northern kingdom of Israel was conquered and destroyed by the Assyrians. And they carried the people off into captivity. And then they brought other slaves in and they forced them to intermarry. So by the time of Jesus, you have the Samaritans are half Jewish and half something else. And in addition to that, after the division between the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah, Jerusalem and the temple were in the southern kingdom of Judah, the Samaritans from the north couldn't get down there anymore. It wasn't their country. They couldn't just go to worship at the temple. And so the decision was made early on, in fact it's captured in Scripture, that they decided they would have their different ways of worshiping. They set up golden calves in two places. And particularly, they decided that God had ordained that it was okay for them to worship instead of in Jerusalem on Mount Gerizim, which is right outside the city of Samaria. Well, the Samaritan Pentateuch is very similar to the Hebrew Bible, except for a few things. It's got 11 commandments, for instance. The 11th commandment says that God has ordained that they should worship on Mount Gerizim, and that's fine. And there are a few other obvious places. But other than that, it is one of the most ancient of the source documents we have. And with the exception of the places it clearly is off, you know, like the 11th commandment, that's not anywhere else, that it's unique to them. then it's considered a source for a lot of the other things in the Hebrew Bible. Now, there are still about 1,000 Samaritans alive today. Only about 1,000, but their Samaritans aren't entirely gone. But this is, and there were some other ancient kind of sources as well, you know, various other documents that were written in other languages, Aramaic Gospels, Syriac, etc. We then have the Talmud. The Talmud is a Jewish document. It comes from the word for instruction or learning. There are two components. This was written about 200 to 500 AD, and the reason is Jewish, while the Hebrew Bible existed, all of the commentary on the Hebrew Bible, all of the, you know, how many books do we have in our little library here at the church that are commentaries on Scripture? Well, all of that in the Hebrew world, in the Jewish world, all of that was oral. It wasn't written down. They had a thing against writing it down. They would memorize it and pass it on. And teachers would teach their students the commentaries on the Hebrew Bible. Well, after Jerusalem was destroyed in 700 AD, which is another reason we don't have a lot of the ancient documents, because any of them that had existed until then, they got burned when the temple was burned in 70 AD. The Talmud had all been oral. It was oral commentary. And then after Jerusalem was destroyed, the people went into exile, a bunch of bad stuff. Some of the Hebrew scholars started saying, you know, if we don't start writing this stuff down, on a really bad day, a bunch of us could be dead and we wouldn't remember this stuff anymore. So starting about 200 AD, they started writing down the oral law of the commentary on the Hebrew scriptures and other religious things. It's two major parts in the Talmud: the Mishnah, which is a compendium of the oral law, and then the Gemara, which is a commentary on it. It expands on it, and etc. Altogether, the Talmud is about 6,200 pages long, and they used to memorize it. And this is became the basis for what's called Rabbinic Judaism. Rabbinic Judaism is what's still practiced today, you know, the teachings of the rabbis. There were different schools, like the school of Hillel and the school of Shammai were two of the major ones. Different teachers and leaders that would do interpretations. All of that is the kind of stuff that's in Talmud. How many of you have seen the movie Yentl with Barbra Streisand? You know the part where, I mean, the whole thing is going to school. And there's a scene, a great scene, where they're sitting in the back of a wagon on their way back to school and they're having an argument on when the day starts. Well, is it when you can see your shadow? And if it, all of that, and they've got books open in front of them. All of that is from the Talmud. Those are Talmudic writings on all manner of things. It has to do not only with religion, but with social culture and morals and, you know, family practice and all kinds of stuff. But because a lot of this is commentary on the Hebrew Bible is extensively quoted in the Talmud. And so it too is a source. Yes?
Another great book that turned into a movie, I thought the book was much better, was The Chosen, which talked about the traditions of this. That was
right.
Jewish.
Chaim Potok is the writer, and he's... My name is Asher Lev, and he's got some great books. Yes.
But he was specifically a scholar of the Talmud, and that's when they went to school yeshiva. This is all they studied.
Yeah.
I don't think they really studied a lot of like math or...
Well, they basic education was something that they would learn in the home from very early on. I mean,
when they went to school, isn't this what they studied?
Well, the Talmudic schools, yes, that this is the primary focus of it. But it's not like in some of the Islamic schools, to be quite honest, in parts of the world, they specifically don't teach anything other than Quran. Whereas in the Jewish schools, there was always a tradition of appreciating learning overall. And so there would be an emphasis on overall learning. But the Talmudic schools would focus on just the Talmud. Yeah. All right, then we have the Latin Vulgate. So we've gone through different translations. By the 4th century AD, so this is 400 years after Jesus, the dominant language in the world, you know, who had conquered the Mediterranean basin by that point? The Romans. And what do the Romans speak? Latin. Now, most of them also spoke Greek. Latin is the Roman language. In fact, Latin is called a Romance language, and all of the languages that are based upon Latin are called Romance languages, like French and Spanish and Italian. Okay. So, 4th century AD, the Pope at that time, Damasus I, asked for one of the premier scholars of that day, Saint Jerome, he became a saint later, to translate the Septuagint, the Greek Bible, into Latin so it could be used in the Western churches. Because by that time, the Eastern churches, which were centered in Constantinople, we now know of them as the Orthodox churches, Eastern Orthodox, you know, Russian Orthodox, etc. And the Western church, which is the Roman Catholic Church, as we know it, already they had begun to use different languages in their services. In the Roman churches, they use Latin. And so they said, we need a Latin version of the Bible. So, great scholar that he was, St. Jerome, he translated the Septuagint into Latin. And that became the Latin Vulgate. Vulgate is from the root word vulgar. It doesn't mean nasty, it means common. Right? And so it was the commonly used version of the Bible in the Latin churches. Right? So, and another interesting thing, by the way, when the Septuagint was translated in the 3rd century BC, these are Jewish scholars, there was a period of time right before that, in the intertestamental period, when some extraordinary things happened historically for the Jews. The Hasmonean period, where the Jews were invaded, if you will, by the Seleucid Empire. Seleucus had been one of the generals of Alexander the Great, and his descendants controlled that part of the Middle East. They tried to force the Jews to get rid of Judaism, to worship the pagan gods. Well, they rebelled against them, and they fought back. This was the Maccabean Rebellion, it's called. And they drove them off. And this is where we get Hanukkah. Around Christmas time, we'll have Hanukkah, which is the Jewish holiday. This year, it's actually from the night of December 24th to January 1st. It's Hanukkah this year. It's 8 days. The whole idea was that because they had driven the Seleucids out, they had re-cleansed the temple, they sort of relaunched Judaism when it had been threatened terribly. The writings about that, 1st and 2nd Maccabees, 3rd Esdras, Tobit, Judith, Bell and the Dragon, these are various books. They were translated, with the Septuagint, they were translated into Greek, not because they were thought of as being part of the Bible, but because they were thought, this is important history. And since we have them in Hebrew, but since the Jews can't read Hebrew anymore, they can only read Greek, let's translate those two, not because they're part of the Bible, but because they're part of our history, and they're important for people, Jewish people, to read. Right? Okay. Then you get to the Latin Vulgate. Jerome, St. Jerome, comes along, and he's translating everything to Latin. He made the same decision. He said, these books, the intertestamental books, called the Apocrypha. Apocrypha means hidden writing. These books are not part of the canon. In fact, Jerome specifically identified them as deuterocanonical, second level. In other words, they're helpful, it's good history, it's good things to know, but they're not canon, they're not part of God's Word. He translated those into Latin. All well and good until the 1500s, when the Protestant Reformation comes along. And one of the things the Protestant Reformation, and by the way, in the interim, the Jews, during the Masoretic text thing, there was a Council of Jamnia, when they were trying to solidify what is our official Bible, they looked at those and said, okay, yeah, they're fun history, but that's not part of the Bible. The Jews had decided the apocryphal books were not part of canon. We get to the Protestant Reformation, and Luther and Zwingli and all those guys say, wait a minute, the Jews don't think this is part of the Hebrew Bible. Nowhere are they quoted in the New Testament. Jesus doesn't refer to them specifically. We don't think they should be in the Bible, so they took them out. Well, late in the 1500s, when the Catholics finally got their act together and decided they better do something about this Protestant growth, they, in the Council of Trent, they had what's called the Council of the Counter-Reformation. Counter-Reformation meaning they're going to fight back against the Reformation. They said several things, which some of the doctrines we have the most difficulty with were actually approved in order to fight against the Protestant movement. One of them was, because the Protestants had said the apocryphal books are not part of our Bible, even though the Catholics had not up until then thought that they were the same as the rest of the Bible, I get this impression that they're in a meeting, and one of the cardinals goes, well, if they say they're not part of the Bible, we'll show them it's going to be equal to the rest of the Bible. And at that point, the Council of Trent in the late 1500s, they made the Apocrypha part of the official Catholic Bible. If you have a Catholic Bible today, or a Jerusalem Bible, which is an ecumenical Bible, it will have, in between the Old and New Testament, seven other books. 1st and 2nd Maccabees, 3rd Esdras, Tobit, Judith, Bell and the Dragon, and an extension of the Book of Daniel. Okay? And then the Eastern Orthodox churches, the Orthodox churches, they add a couple more, even over that. So that's how a Catholic book has different... I've often thought, get up for a sermon sometime and say, okay, turn with me, if you will, to the second book of Maccabees, the 14th chapter. And people go, is that Old New Testament? I don't know, keep looking, you know. But that's to, you know, the Catholics use that as part of their scripture now, and it's because even though Jerome said it's not part of canon, they made it that in the 1500s. Yes?
Do they have any historical basis to these books? I mean, was there anything in them that maybe weren't from God, but did they have things in there that helped you understand more about the Old Testament?
Well, no. They have things in there that help you understand more of the history of the Jewish people, but they also have dragons. And kind of weird stuff. I mean, you read them and you go, I don't think so. And, you know, there's another category even. Those are the apocryphal, the hidden books. There's a collection of books called the pseudepigrapha, which means false writing, not hidden writing, but false writing. And that includes a lot of the Gnostic Gospels, for instance, the Gospel of Thomas, you know, the Gospel according to Mary, and various others. And nobody other than Elaine Pagels, I think, you know, who's a liberal scholar, really thinks those should be considered equal to Bible, but she's made a career out of that. And again, the reason they translated was the history is valuable, but the theology is really awful. I mean, it doesn't fit. It does not make sense. There's mysterious, you know, there's 151st Psalm, for instance. Okay, there's another Psalm in there. And yet, theologians, Jewish and Christian alike, up until the Council of Trent, said, okay, they're useful to learn the history, but don't read them for theology. But then the Council of Trent made up theology. It's sort of a vindictive kind of stomp my little feet and tell you, you know. So that's the Latin Vulgate. Now the Dead Sea Scrolls. Carolyn.
Up here you say it's primarily from ancient Hebrew documents, but what you said was that it was...
Well, it was both.
Okay.
He used the Septuagint.
Okay.
But because he still had access to a lot of documents we don't anymore, he used ancient Hebrew documents as well. And so that's why the Latin Vulgate also is valuable when you're looking at the history of Scripture. It's not just a translation from Greek to Latin. It's also using some other sources. And so the process today, it's a very complicated process deciding what is the most accurate representation of the original sources. Hopefully you begin to see that.
One more thing.
Sure, go ahead.
Florette's question, I think. Maccabees is where you get the story of Hanukkah, though, right?
What, right, well, because that's the historical event.
Mm-hmm.
Hanukkah was...
It's a miracle, right?
Yeah, it is a miracle. The story of the miracle of Hanukkah is in there, and the miracle of the oil. I just wrote a letter about this for client, Jewish Voice, because we're getting close to Hanukkah. The miracle was that the small Jewish rebel army was able to defeat the army of the Seleucids, which was a powerful, significant force. And then they also... They went into the temple where they had set up an idol to Zeus, you know, a place to worship Zeus, and they had sacrificed pigs on this idol in the temple in Jerusalem. And so the whole thing had to be cleansed, you know, physically clean, spiritually clean, and that was going to be an eight-day process. Well, when they got in, they only had one day's worth of kosher oil to burn in the lamps, the menorahs. You know, a menorah is a seven-branched candelabra. You've seen them. Well, by faith, they started the process anyway, and what was only supposed to be enough oil for one day lasted for 8 days. And that's why it's called the Festival of Lights, also the Festival of Dedication, because they rededicated the temple. And that's the miracle of the oil. And it took them 8 days to get some new kosher oil, because the oil had been polluted, you know. And so that miracle is why you have 8 days of Hanukkah, and in fact, there's a special kind of Hanukkah menorah called a Hanukkiah, which has 9 branches, and it's 8 branches for the 8 miracle days that the menorah burned, and then a servant candle, which is used to light the others, you know, one each day for Hanukkah.
Oh, there's one to burn.
Yeah. So that's and that story is in Maccabees, because the Maccabean revolt, rebellion, was when they drove the Seleucids off and recaptured and rededicated the Jerusalem temple, and that's the story of Hanukkah. Okay. Then the Dead Sea Scrolls. We're getting close to the end here, guys. You're almost done. Dead Sea Scrolls. The oldest documents we had in Hebrew, then, were after the time of Christ until the 1940s. 1947, actually for several years, because they continued, once they found the first of these, they found others. The story was that this is an area near the Dead Sea, and if you've ever, any of y'all ever been in that area, if you drive along, there are these cliffs, sort of rough hillsides, and you can see caves in them. You know, there's all sorts of natural indentations and caves and things. The story is that a young shepherd boy was chasing a goat one time, and in frustration, he threw a rock at it and went into one of these caves, and he heard pottery break. And he went in to see what it was, and he discovered several large ceramic jugs that had been sealed and put in there. And it's a very dry place. Okay, this part of the world is there's virtually no rainfall. And they had been sealed in these pottery things. And it turned out that it was when they found them all, there were a total of 972 ancient texts, some of which go back as far as 400s BC. Some of them are 300 AD, so there's a period of about 700 years there. They were written and collected by a group called the Essenes community. It was a sort of apocalyptic community that of Jews that lived in that area. They had a monastic community, the Qumran community. That area is called Qumran. And sometimes these are called the Qumran Scrolls even, although Dead Sea Scrolls is the most common name for them now. And they are the oldest of Hebrew, and that's why when we found them, and there are some 400 years before Jesus, and most of them are actually from the Hebrew Bible. Like the whole book of Isaiah, all of it is there. And large sections of other Hebrew Bibles. There's also about 30% of it is everyday life, like accounting kinds of stuff, and instructions for how to live as an Essene. Whatnot, but mostly it's Hebrew Bible. And so that's the oldest source of documents we have we can now compare, and that's when they discovered the modern versions we have are virtually unchanged. Any changes that have occurred are insignificant in terms of not having any change in meaning. A change in spelling, for instance. Or a word is made plural when it was singular before, but not anything that has any meaning. And so that's why the more liberal scholars had always said, oh, this has got to be way different than the original. They had to come up with a new theory, and that was that the people who were the scribes, the people who wrote, copied these, they saw that as a calling from God. They saw that as the most important thing they would ever do in their life, and so they did not make mistakes. Mm-hmm. Nothing of consequence. They didn't add stuff or take things away because they didn't like them, because they didn't see that that was their right. And the Dead Sea Scrolls are tremendously important for establishing the believability and the accuracy of Scripture. Okay? They're written in Hebrew, in Greek, in Aramaic, and in Nabataean. Who knows who the Nabataeans were? Well, Carolyn does. Yes. Betty?
I know where the Nabataeans
were. Right. Petra. The city of Petra was the capital of the Nabataean Empire. There was a point at which, Carolyn knows because I've lectured on the Nabataeans and on Petra in some of the cruises we've done. The Nabataeans, at one point, their empire, it was a trade empire, and they were water technicians, so they managed to have water in the desert where nobody else could. The Nabataean Empire at one point was almost half the size of the Roman Empire as its largest. Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of that was open desert, you know, to be honest, the Arabian Peninsula and all of that. But still, they were very significant. And some of the Dead Sea Scrolls are written in their language, in Nabataean. It's a language that you can see carved into stone if you go to Petra. Okay.
So were Nabataeans Jewish?
No, they were...
Why were they written in Nabataean?
Nabataean. Well, it was a Semitic language.
What?
Semitic language.
Semitic language.
Hebrew, Arabic, Aramaic, which was the language of the Babylonians. The Nabataean. All of those languages are all of the same family. You know, languages come in families. That's why I said that the Romance languages, like Italian, Spanish, French, are all based upon Latin. English is not a Romance language. English is a Germanic language. But the Norman conquest messed everything up. That's why English is such a weird hodgepodge. It's a Germanic-rooted language, but we've got a lot of Romance influence. That's why there's a lot of cognate words in Spanish and English, because of the French Normans conquered England and infected the language with all that stuff. So you get families of languages, and the Nabataean language was common in that area, and so they would have some things written by someone who spoke Nabataean. It was a Semitic language, so it wasn't that far off of Aramaic or some of the others. But that's why. You know, these were Jews, but there would have been people there from different places. Maybe they converted. Maybe they had written documents, somebody else had written documents for them, but there are some things there in Nabataean language. Now, there's not an absolute agreement in any of the ancient authoritative Old Testament documents. In other words, there are minor differences, but they are only minor differences. And they are not in any way theologically significant. And that's critical to understand. And the Dead Sea Scrolls especially made it clear that what we have today, we believe, is 98 to 99% accurate to the original writings. All right?
It's amazing. It's truly amazing.
And what I might do at some point later on, I do this usually in How to Study the Bible, is I've got some charts that show how many original documents we have and how close they are to the original writing in the Bible compared to the next closest, and it just blows you away. Walt?
I was going to say, the Dead Sea Scrolls, the scribes, the Assyrians, they were doing this when they came across the name Jehovah, whatever it was. Mm-hmm. They changed writing instruments because it was now, oops.
It's a holy word, yeah.
It's a holy word, and then they have to get a new.
Right.
When you say it's 98 to 99% accurate, and the other 1 or 2% is what you talked about spelling changings, plurals, things like that.
Or it's something that is clearly pointed out. For instance, if you take any translation of the Bible and look at the end of the book of Mark, there's a section there that is set aside. And it says the earliest versions do not include this passage. Now, because more than one more recent version did, they'll include it, but they put brackets around it. They tell you, be careful here, all right? So there are some changes like that that would be included in that 1 or 2% as well, but we know it and we recognize it, you know, and it's things like the fact that there are 11 commandments in the Samaritan Pentateuch, okay? Though that would be included in that 1 to 2%, but other than that, it's just like abbreviations or you know, added letter here or there, but no, nothing of significance, okay? So, and people who say otherwise, I don't think have studied it. And most even non-Christian scholars today would acknowledge the, you know, the extraordinary reliability. We're a few minutes over, but I'm going to take 2 more minutes and introduce one more subject because it's something you will run into if you read about any of this stuff. And that is the documentary hypothesis. sorry. German scholars. There have been some great German theologians, and there have been some really problematic German theologians. Well, in the 18th and 19th centuries, some of the, particularly German theologians, some others as well, came up with what's called the documentary hypothesis. Julius Wellhausen is the most common one. Sometimes this is called the Wellhausen hypothesis. They began to note that in the Pentateuch, this only applies to the first 5 books, which is the most important part of the Hebrew Bible, that in the first 5 books, that there are different places where there are different words used to refer to God. Some places they call him Yahweh. Some places they call him Elohim. Again, a generic word for God. Adonai means Lord. Elohim means God. It's like when we spell it with a small g, right? They also noticed that there were different styles that split. There are some things, this kind of idea carried on. Some people believe that there are 2 writers of the book of Isaiah because there appear to be a split in 2 different styles. Well, what they came up with is they believed that the Pentateuch, the first 5 books of the Bible, were written by 4 different schools, not people, that Moses didn't write any of it. And the reason they said that is because they had several founding premises behind this theory, this hypothesis. One was that Moses would not have been able to write because it was too early. So he couldn't have written. That has been disproven in the 20th century many, many times over. We have found writings much older than Moses that they could write perfectly well, thank you very much. And the fact that he was an adopted prince in Egypt, the most sophisticated culture in the world at that time, he almost certainly would have had a wonderful education, okay, because he was adopted into that family. And so that idea was one of their premises. That doesn't hold anymore. The other thing was that as they began working with all of this, they assumed that there were form problems, meaning like they would take the first and second chapters of Genesis, and they would say, okay, these are 2 completely different creation stories. They must have been written by 2 different people. Well, form criticism is a type of theological analysis, scriptural analysis, that came into its own in the 20th century. And they look at that and go, absolutely not. Hebrew does that all the time. Genesis 1 is the story of creation in broad strokes, and then Genesis 2 focuses in on the most important part, which is the people. It doesn't have to be 2 different people. It's 2 different chapters by the same person. And he's just focusing in. So the form criticism idea. And part of that was that they denied that there was any possibility of anything miraculous. And they said, since the whole of the Old Testament is based on miraculous stuff, you can't believe that it is what it says anyway. They just dismissed that out of hand. That's sort of the basis of all this. And they came up saying there were four different sources, which they identified as J, E, D, and P. And you will run into this. You'll be reading along in some commentary, and it will say, you know, we believe this is a product of the E sources. J stands for Yahwist, the ones that use the word Yahweh. The reason it's J instead of Y is because this guy's German. Yah is spelled J-A. Elohist is the E. Deuteronomist, this is the writer of Deuteronomy, and some pieces they believed of others, is D. And the priestly source is the source of all the ritual stuff, like you get in Leviticus. And they set dates on this, that they believe the Yahwist source was writing around 950 BC in the kingdom of Judah. Notice this is 450 to 500 years after, we believe, Moses wrote it. That's a long time. The Elohist, they said, wrote in 850 in the kingdom of Israel in the north. Deuteronomist, around 600 BC in Jerusalem. And the priestly source, around 500 BC in exile in Babylon. There is no support for these ideas. There is no documentation with this. This is just their idea of what it might have been like. And yet, up until the last 20 or 30 years, this had been accepted as the correct interpretation. And it completely dismisses any idea that God had anything to do with writing this stuff.
Why was it so widely accepted?
Well, liberal scholarship was the thing. And, you know, it was cool.
It was new.
It was cool. Just like those scholars, you know, the guy that, you know, the Jesus seminar kind of stuff. So you're going to run into this. That's the only reason I mentioned it to you now. I do not believe that most scholars today have discounted this, and they have other explanations for their concerns. Any questions about any of this?
Who still claims this? Or?
There are still some liberal scholars that would you'll hear. They don't sort of claim, I don't know of anybody who claims the whole package anymore, but you'll still read somebody saying, oh, this seems to be a reference to the second Yahwist source or whatever.
Okay, so it's kind of fallen apart, except it's kind of picked and chosen. Exactly. I like this part.
Yeah.
You can like that part.
Right. I mean, there are still a lot of liberal scholars out there that would agree with their premises, that nothing can be miraculous, that, you know, etc. Although nobody would say Moses couldn't write anymore. That's been discounted completely. Yes.
Is that where this comes from when people say to me, oh, the Bible, you know, it was written by a bunch of old men that just said what they wanted to say?
Well, this would certainly would support that idea. People who say that, I mean, just like people who say, oh, you know, there's all sorts of inconsistencies in the Bible, or whatever, or God is so mysterious, you know, we can't really know anything about God. They haven't bothered to read the book.
Well, I'm sure they haven't.
You know, it's the main thing. Thank you all very much. I hope you can come tomorrow at 1 o'clock for the New Testament, and we'll meet back here next Friday.